Hello, welcome back, everyone. As you've seen, you've had a wonderful treat. That was a fantastic lecture by Dr. Andrews, and we have more coming. I just want to let you folks know I mentioned some of our programs, and I briefly mentioned our biography program, Lunch with Friends and Strangers, which takes place on Fridays at noon. Of course, we finished this semester's roster of Friends and Strangers, but we have another one coming up, three wonderful sessions in June. We'll be having our guests will be David Fenning, who will be talking about Mary Anning, a paleontologist. We have the wonderful Annegret Fauser from Music discussing Aaron Copland. And from American Studies, we have Dan Cobb talking about the American Indian activist and writer Darcy McNichol. Really wonderful, a wonderful opportunity to learn about people that sometimes are obscure or perhaps famous, and you get to know them a little bit better. So come and check that out. I also bring that up to point you folks to our YouTube channel. We want to encourage you to go there. We have our own channel on YouTube, and I think Paul is probably dropping this information for you. So many of our events, anyone who is seeing this now, who has signed up for this, will be able to watch it later. But many other events we put on there free of charge. And so we have a wonderful selection of work. You can see some of our K-12 work in action, some of our community college work in action, and all of our Lunch with Friends and Strangers end up being available on YouTube. We do have a little delay between when we air them and when we put them on. So please go to that, check that out. That's one of the things we've learned in this virtual world is how to do stuff like this. And of course, to take advantage of these resources, YouTube has been around for 16 years and now we're really taking advantage of it. So please check it out. And of course, follow us on Facebook. We even have an Instagram account. Of course, go to humanities.unc to get more information, unc.edu, excuse me, let me finish that, to get more information on our products and all of our different events that we have coming up. Let's not waste any more time. We've got some athletics to go to. Cold War battles in the Olympics coming up next. One more time, my friends, please welcome Dr. Matt Anderson.
Andrews, what am I saying?
That's all right. That's a Max. That's all right. I have something coming your way actually in this talk. So, all right, this is fun. I'm excited to give this a second shot during the break. Max and Paul and I were talking and I was saying just how weird it was to be standing up teaching. So I feel like I'm getting my sea legs. So I'm ready to give this another shot. So thank you for those who have come back.
Whatever
my name is. For this portion of our seminar, we are going to explore one particular manifestation of those nationalist rivalries at the Games. So right now, I want to explore the relationship between the Olympics and the Cold War, which I hinted at a little bit in the question and answer last time. The story of the Cold War dominates the Olympics narrative from the early 1950s to the late 1980s, so we can't even come close to covering it all. So I'm going to touch on many different aspects of the Cold War Olympic Games, but I'm going to focus on the early Cold War Olympic Games, so really on the 1950s, though I'm happy to answer questions about the 80s, anything you want to talk about. And the story that I want to start with, it's from the 1950s Cold War era. And it both is and isn't a Cold War story, but it's such a good story. You're gonna see what I mean. And I start with the story because I think it's a good transition about what we were talking about just now about sport and nationalism and the story of the Cold War. So we're gonna start with a story from the 1956 Melbourne Summer Olympic Games. Now we have summer games, summer and winter that is. These were the first Olympic Games in the Southern Hemisphere. Though these were summer games, they actually took place in late November, early December, the Australian summer. And this means then that they took place at the end of the year, and a little more specifically, at the end of a chaotic and turmoil-filled year. 1956 was a year of international tensions and crises. The Cold War was escalating. There was the Suez Crisis in Egypt. This was not a big cargo ships stuck in the canal. This was a coordinated invasion of Egypt by Israel, England, and France. And in the late part of 1956, there was the Soviet invasion of Hungary. In 1956, Hungarian reformers, they were calling for new political freedoms in Hungary. They wanted to be able to speak openly and debate ideas. They were calling for an end to the Soviet domination of their political system. And it was a moment of optimism and excitement about the future. Hungary had been dominated by the Soviets since the end of World War II, and now it looked like, you know, real independence was coming. It was just around the corner. And then the Soviet leader, Nikita Khrushchev, he decided to crush this optimism. Khrushchev sent in the Soviet tanks and Soviet troops. They stormed through Budapest. There was a bloody struggle where 2,500 Hungarians were killed. And this crackdown, the Soviet crackdown of the Hungarians in Budapest, it was occurring right as the nations of the world, they were convening in Melbourne for the Olympic Games. And as fate would have it, all of this was happening back in, as it was all happening back in Budapest, the water polo teams from these two nations, Hungary and the Soviet Union, they met in the pool in the semifinals of the Olympic water polo competition. And here's what happened, and this is incredible. Things were tense, of course, but the Soviet and the Hungarian players, they embraced each other, they wished each other luck, and then they played a spirited but clean game. I don't even remember who won. I mean, nobody does. That's not the point. It was the dignity of the sportsman that everyone remembers. Responding to the sportsmanship that their athletes had shown, Soviet and Hungarian leaders, they called for a truce on the streets of Budapest. They began a new round of negotiations. And inspired by their newfound respect for the Hungarians, right, watching those Hungarian athletes against their athletes, the Soviet leaders, they peacefully withdrew from Budapest and freedom came to Hungary. Sports had healed political wounds. Sports had made the world a better place. Nope, that's not what happened. I'm sorry to be the one to break it to you, but sports just do not have that power. This is what happened. First of all, the political leader of the Hungarian reform movement, Imre Nagy, he was arrested and then later executed. Right? A hardline pro-Soviet leader was installed. In response to the Soviet invasion of Hungary, and in response to the fact that the Soviet Union was in Melbourne for these games, three nations boycotted the 1956 games in protest: Spain, Holland, and Switzerland. They said, we're sorry, if the Soviets are there, we cannot in good conscience attend these games. It's actually 1956. This is when that phenomenon of nations boycotting Olympic games, this is when it first began. And then there was this water polo match. The Soviets and the Hungarians, they met in the semifinals of the water polo competition, and the arena was filled with Hungarian Australians. They waved Hungarian flags. They jeered the Soviet players from start to finish. The Hungarians, they got out to a 2-0 lead. And then the Hungarian players, they started taunting the Soviets. They called them invaders. They called them murderers. And then all hell broke loose. In the final minute of the game, a Soviet player, tired of the verbal attacks, he swung a vicious elbow and he split open the cheek of one of the Hungarian players, and the water polo, the pool, it turned red with all of the blood. Some of the Hungarian supporters from the crowd, they ran to the pool. They started threatening the Soviet players. The Australian police had to come in. They separated everyone. The game was stopped. The Hungarians were declared the winners. But blood was boiling. Here's the one of the headlines. Here's a photograph of one of the Australian newspapers the next day. The headline in the Melbourne Age was "Fists Flew and Blood Flowed." And then how about this? Those Hungarian water polo players there, they did not want to return to Budapest. They did not want to return to Soviet-controlled Hungary. And the United States government sensed an opportunity. American sports writers, Sports Illustrated writers, they made contact with Hungarian athletes and they asked them, do you want to defect to the United States? One by one, Hungarian athletes began disappearing into the night, just walking out of the Olympic Village into waiting cars driven by American CIA agents. 38 athletes in all, 38 Hungarian athletes, they were whisked away. They were hidden in safe houses throughout Melbourne, waiting for the Soviets to actually leave at the end of the Olympics. And then in late December, all 38, they boarded a jet. They flew to San Francisco. They arrived in the United States on Christmas Eve, 1956. And this is when they began their new lives as Americans. And this is when the Soviets accused the Americans of being kidnappers and fanning the flames of the Cold War. In 1944, an American political scientist coined a new term, superpower. And a superpower, he said, is a nation that has great power plus great mobility of power. A superpower is a nation that has the ability to project their power anywhere throughout the world. And at the end of World War II, this meant two nations, right? It meant the United States, clearly, the only nation with the atomic bomb, a nation that had been spared the physical destruction of the war, had successfully waged war in Europe and Asia. And it meant the Soviet Union, a nation that had endured in World War II, it had endured the Nazi storm during the war, and now whose army was in position to exert influence, right, by spreading westward into Europe and southward into Asia. And from the end of World War II to the start of the 1990s, the battle between these two superpowers dominated the globe. And it's known as the Cold War. And I realize I probably don't need to be telling you all this, but I certainly do when I talk to my students about the Cold War. They need to, more than a refresher, I guess. The Cold War was many things, as these photographs suggest. It was a battle to secure natural resources and access to markets. It was a contest for scientific breakthroughs. It was an arms race to see who could develop the most powerful weapons of mass destruction. It was a race to see who could get a man into space and a man on the moon first. It was a military contest. And the Cold War was a sports competition. Every 4 years, the Olympic Games provided a theater for the Cold War, where the athletes from the United States and the Soviet Union, not to mentioned Canada and Czechoslovakia and Poland and Hungary and so on, where the athletes from these nations, but particularly these two nations here, they went head to head. And where the medal count provided another way to gauge which of these two superpowers was the most powerful of all. And when these Cold War athletic battles began in the 1950s, it was 1952, and I'll tell you that story in just a second. It was the head of the International Olympic Committee. Coubertin is dead now. And it's an American named Avery Brundage. And he said, some misguided persons seem to think that Olympic sport can be made a political tool. This is as erroneous as anything can be. The minute politics are permitted in the Olympics, the games are finished. How wrong he was. It was the exact opposite. Once Cold War politics came to the Games, once the tensions of the Cold War were put on display at the Olympic Games every 4 years, this is when the Olympic Games exploded in popularity. The whole world was paying attention. The first Olympics of the Cold War era took place in London in 1948. And the Olympic Games had been canceled in 1940. And in 1944, because of World War II. And now they were back, and they were in London, a city that had endured the Nazi air raid, a city that was a symbol of the Allied resistance. But things were tough in London in 1948. There was rubble everywhere in the months leading up to the games. The city was pockmarked by the bombs. Londoners were dealing with a food shortage, an energy crisis. Actually, teams from other countries, they were told, bring your own food. We're not sure we're going to have enough food to feed your athletes. There were those in London who said we should not be hosting Olympic Games in these conditions. The Soviet Union was not there. The Soviet Union did not participate in 1948 as they were still reeling from a war that had killed 21 million Soviet soldiers and citizens, 21 million. and with many nations still devastated by the war. It was actually the United States, the much healthier United States Olympic team, that dominated these Olympic Games. The U.S. had not been invaded during the war. Diets were way better in the United States than anywhere else in the world. Americans were physically fit. They were prepared for these games, really unlike everyone else, and the United States dominated. But by the next Olympics, the whole vibe is going to be different. The rest of the world is going to be back on its feet. Global diets will have improved. Athletes everywhere are going to be stronger. And another reason that 1952 is very different is that the Soviet Union is going to be at the Olympic Games. The history of sport in the Soviet Union is very different than the history of sport in the United States. The Soviets thought about sports differently than the Americans did. You know, at first, the Soviet leaders, I'm not talking Russia, I'm talking the Soviet Union. So we're starting our story really here in the 1920s. The Soviet Union ignored international sports, or more accurately, they rejected international sports. As the Soviet leaders saw it, international sports and the Olympic Games, they were the playthings of the West, the capitalist West. You know, competition, obsession over winning and setting records, these were the vices of nations with competitive capitalist systems, winners and losers. The Soviets said, we're not interested in these things. International competition at the Olympics, that's what the Americans do. That's what the Nazis do. But after World War II, the Soviet leadership, they changed their tune. After the war, they started to think, how can we use sports to our advantage? How can we use sports in order to try to maximize our influence throughout the world, throughout this new Cold War world? And really, they made the decision to start competing in international sports, like at the Olympic Games. And really, they began competing in international sports with one goal in mind. They wanted to defeat the United States. Defeat the United States, their Cold War rival, at the Olympic Games. And so they got busy. Right after the war, the Soviets, they set up these training sites all under the auspices of this organization. And they were scouring the country, looking for young athletic talent. You know, Soviet boys and girls, they would show off their gymnastic skills, their ice hockey skills. They threw the javelin. They put the shot. And the best and most promising young talent, it was identified and it was sent to Moscow for advanced training, right, where these young athletes could be molded into hopefully future Olympians. And when word got out in the United States about what the Soviets were doing, Americans, they were outraged by this system, horrified by this system. For Americans, things like this, institutes like this Soviet sports system, it was the perfect example of all that was wrong with the Soviet Union. Now, here was a system in which individuals, the critics said, do not have free choice. Here was a system where individuals are told where to go and what to do by their government. But for the Soviets, this was exactly what the socialist system could achieve. You know, everyone pitching in, everyone doing their part, everyone's talents being identified, and then the state supporting people as they develop those talents and those skills for the betterment of the nation. And so here is the key idea at these Cold War Olympic Games. And let's think about this for a second. You know, on the one hand, we might argue that a victory in international sports is meaningless, right? Fine, that American can throw the shot put further and that Soviet can throw the javelin further. So what? Who cares? But if you dig deeper, the question being answered at these Cold War Olympic Games is this: which of these nations has the better system in which to create strong human beings? Which nation has the best system for maximizing human potential? Is it the Americans with a system based on individualism and competition, you know, capitalism? Or is it the Soviets with their socialist system in which centralized planning is emphasized, in which everything is directed by the state, and athletes are said to represent the selfless essence of communism. Both sides said our system is better. Both sides said our system is best, and they were going to prove it at the Olympic Games. The Soviets they attended their first Olympic Games in the summer of 1952, and these summer games were in Helsinki, Finland. And by 1952, the Cold War was red hot, or ice cold. Max, what are you supposed to say? It was exacerbated. I know. Yeah, I don't know. It was intense, is what we're trying to say here. By 1952, the Soviets, they had tightened their grip on Eastern Europe. This is why the British statesman Winston Churchill, he described what the Soviets were doing. He said that an iron curtain has descended across the European continent. By 1952, the Soviets, they had detonated their own atomic bomb. That superpower had just gotten a lot more powerful. At the start of the 1950s, the United States and the USSR, they found themselves on opposite sides of the Korean War. The United States had soldiers in Korea fighting this war. The Soviets, they were supplying the Chinese and the North Korean troops that were doing battle with the United States. You know, by the summer of 1952, the world seemed to be caught up in an all-out struggle between the American way of life and the Soviet way of life. And then came the Olympic Games. There was a widely read columnist for the New York Times named Arthur Daly. And just before these games began, he gave his readers a taste of what was about to come. He wrote, "There will be 71 nations in the Olympics at Helsinki. The United States would like to beat all of them, but the only one that counts is Soviet Russia. The communist propaganda machine must be silenced. In sports, the Red Brothers have reached the put up or shut up stage. Let's shut them up." The games began. The 1952 Helsinki Summer Olympics commenced. There was the opening ceremony where there was the traditional parade of nations. There was the reciting of the Olympic oath. The Olympic torch was brought into the stadium. That's the great Finnish distance runner, Paavo Nurmi. He was a star in the 20s and the 30s. He got to bring the Olympic torch into the stadium. Next came a speech from a German college student. She walked to the podium and she spoke about global peace, about the horrors of atomic war. She called on the United States and the USSR to immediately destroy their atomic arsenals. Her name was Barbara Rautrat-Plyer. She called herself the Peace Angel of Helsinki. And then in her flowing white dress, she began to run a lap around the Olympic Stadium. It took a moment for the Olympic organizers to realize this. She was not supposed to be there. She was just this activist who walked up to the microphone, made her pitch, and then started running around the stadium. You do that now at the Olympic Games and you get vaporized from a drone. But back then she was just, you know, handled, quietly ushered away. The American newspapers the next day, they called her a communist. They called her deranged. Though I gotta say, I'm not sure what's so deranged about calling for global peace and the end of atomic warfare. Anyway, then the competitions, the Cold War competitions. The other nations were there, of course, but the nations with the two strongest teams were the superpowers, the United States and the Soviet Union. The American domination in past Olympic Games came from the U.S. victories in men's track and field and in swimming. Those were the events that the United States historically dominated, men's track and field and swimming. And that indeed is where many of the American medals came from here in 1952. But the Soviets, they came into their first Olympics having prepared for every event, gymnastics, fencing, wrestling, weightlifting, cycling, I mean, everything. And where the Soviets really had the Americans' number and will have it for the next few Olympic Games, it was in women's sports. The Soviets were way better in women's sports than the Americans were. And that's because the Soviets actually cared about women's sports. They spent resources on women's athletics. The United States did not. There was no system for women's sports in the United States. There was no investment in women's sports coming from government. The colleges and the universities that turned out the great male athletes, UCLA, Ohio State, they totally ignored female athletes. And now this sexism was going to hurt the United States in the medal count. Let's talk medal counts for a second. Nations measure themselves against other nations at the Olympic Games. And as the Olympics evolved, there was talk about the need for some sort of official scoring system, a medal count system, to better be able to assess this. And Olympic officials, like Coubertin, they always said no. They opposed medal counts. Coubertin said winning, losing, it doesn't matter. It's the competition. It's just taking part. That's what matters. So we will not count medals. But everyone did it. Reporters and Olympic committees from the powerful nations, they were always counting medals. The United States and the Great Britain, and Great Britain, they did it in 1908. But there were always disagreements about how to do it, how to calculate it. Some thought, well, you should just count total medals. Every medal won counts as 1 point. So a gold, a silver, a bronze, they all count for 1 point. Others said, no. Gold medals have to count more than a silver, and a silver has to count more than a bronze. Winners should get more points. The United States. The United States dominated track and field. And the track and field was sort of the signal event of the Olympic Games, certainly in the United States. And so the American Olympic Committee, they argued that track and field medals should count as more. They should be worth more than other competitions. And others thought this was absurd. All medals should be equal. A fencing medal should be worth the same as winning gold in the 100-meter dash. Some smaller nations, they thought the only fair way to do this was to count medals per capita, right? So establish a ratio of gold medals per, say, every million inhabitants. Otherwise, the big nations will always win the medal count. I think that's a really interesting idea. So I did some calculations. Under this proposal, the winner of the medal count, this ratio system at the last Summer Games, the 2016 Summer Games, it would have been the Bahamas. One gold medal with a population of 388,000. I think the United States would have come in 50th in the medal count. One gold medal for every 50 million inhabitants. Anyway, it's an interesting idea. Olympic officials, they refused to endorse one system or another. But then this became a huge deal in the context of the Cold War, right? The United States and the Soviet Union, they were talking a lot of smack. We need a winner. What eventually evolved was this unofficial system, an unofficial medal count. The IOC never made this official, but an unofficial medal count where a nation got 3 points for a gold, 2 points for a silver, 1 point for a bronze. I think this is reasonable. So let's apply this to Helsinki. At the 1952 games, the Soviets got out to an early lead in the medal count on the strength of their female athletes. And some Americans, they actually complained about this. Arthur Daly, for example, the New York Times, he complained about this. He said women's sports should not be part of the medal count. Sorry, macho man, they count. But then the United States team, it stormed back. It stormed back based on their domination of the track and field events, particularly men's track and field. And there was one event here that I want to mention. The 3,000 meter steeplechase, because come on, when do you ever get to hear someone talk about the steeplechase? Most people who I tell this story to look at me like they have no idea what I'm talking about. What is the steeplechase? And you are forgiven if you do not, but you can get a sense of it from this photograph. The steeplechase is awesome. The steeplechase is an obstacle course where humans basically mimic horses. The name comes from old Irish horse races, where horse and rider, they would race from one village to another with the church steeple in those villages serving as markers, the steeplechase. Then in the mid-19th century in Ireland, humans started racing without horses. They would run from village to village, jumping over stone walls, running through shallow ponds. And that's what the modern steeplechase is. It's a 3,000 meter race on the inside of the track, sometimes on the outside of the track, but not on the track itself. So almost 2 miles. There are 35 waist high hurdles that do not topple. And 7 of them are followed by these 12 foot wide water pits. So the runners, they go over the fence, they go into the water pit, they come out. It is a grueling, awesome spectacle. They started competing in the steeplechase at the Olympics in 1900. And though they cared about the steeplechase in places like Ireland, in the United States, nobody cared. It got no attention. It absolutely flew under the radar until 1952. In 1952, the 3,000 meter steeplechase featured a Cold War matchup that even a Hollywood screenwriter could not have come up with. And there were a dozen entrants in this race. I'm going to zoom in on two of them here. But all eyes were on these two guys here in the front, an American and a Soviet. There was Horace Ashenfelter. That was the American. And okay, I suppose a Hollywood screenwriter could come up with a better name than Horace Ashenfelter. I don't know. Kip Waterman or Max Orr, you know, ridiculous names, both of them. Matt Anderson. But alas, it was Horace Ashenfelter. That was his name. Ashenfelter, though, he was right out of central casting. He was a clean-cut G-man. He was an FBI agent, a symbol of American domestic security during the Cold War, right? During the Red Scare. The man hunted communists for a living. Opposing him was the Soviet steeplechaser, Vladimir Kazantsev, a communist. Kazantsev was a Soviet Red Army hero. He had been wounded in action, defending the Soviet Union against the Nazis in World War II, defending the motherland. Now here he is in 1952. He was the world record holder in this event. So, I mean, it's just perfect. It's the Soviet war hero against the American FBI agent. And going into the final lap of this grueling race, the Soviet, Kazantsev, he had a pretty big lead. And then Ashenfelter, he closed, he moved even. And the crowd was in an absolute frenzy. I mean, most people in the stadium, they were rooting for the American. Remember, these games were in Finland, and the Soviets had invaded Finland during World War II. It wasn't so much a pro-American crowd as it was an anti-Soviet crowd. As the steeplechasers splashed down into the water almost simultaneously on the final hurdle here, it was as if the American Ashenfelter had been just shot out of a cannon. He landed in the water, he sprung out of the water, he sprinted with shocking power and speed into first place, crossed the finish line first, an American victory. Ashenfelter received letters of congratulations from the President of the United States, from J. Edgar Hoover, his boss at the FBI. A steeplechaser became an American hero, a steeplechaser. But again, this wasn't really the steeplechase. This was the Cold War. And Ashenfelter's victory helped propel the United States to an overall victory in the first Cold War medal count. Using our 3-2-1 scoring system, the Americans won the medal count 175 points to the Soviet Union's 145. So this was an American victory, but the United States was a longtime Olympic veteran and power. The Soviets, they were Olympic rookies. It was not nearly as big of a victory as many Americans expected. And it wasn't just a strong showing by the Soviets who came in second. The other communist nations, the other Eastern Bloc nations with the same type of sports system, they did very well also. Hungarian athletes, they won 16 medals, 42 overall, so 84 points. A very strong performance from a nation of 10 million. Czechoslovakia down there, number 6, they did well. And the star of the games, the star of the 1952 games came from behind the so-called Iron Curtain. The singular star of the 1952 Helsinki Games was the Czechoslovakian runner, Emil Zatopek. When I teach my courses on the Olympics here at UNC, one of the struggles that I have is to try to get students to understand why might someone be enamored with or prefer the communist system to the system in the West. I try to get students to think expansively here. And the way I do this is I tell them about Emil Zátopek. Emil Zátopek is one of the most remarkable Olympians of all time. And most of my students are big Michael Phelps fans, which is fine. But give me Zátopek over Phelps any day. And this is partly because I prefer running to swimming, both doing and watching, actually. I mean, swimming is awesome. But one of the things that I think running has going for it over swimming as a spectator sport is that you can see the competitor in the running competitions, the whole competitor. With TV, you can look into their eyes and you can see them suffer. And I guess I'm saying, I'm into that man. Well, nobody seemed to suffer more when running than Emil Zátopek. He ran like a wild animal. He ran like a demented insect, you know, his head back, his eyes bulging out of the sockets, his arms flailing. He just looked like he was in tremendous pain. And I think this is what helped make him so appealing to sports fans all across the globe. Zátopek didn't just seem to want it more. He seemed willing to suffer more than any of the other athletes out there. So I want to tell you about what he did at these games, but I want to use him as an example of someone who, at least early on, was a big supporter of the communist movement in his country. I think he can give us a sense of why communist ideology was so attractive to people in places like Czechoslovakia at this time. So very brief, here's a bio of Zátopek. He grew up in Czechoslovakia. He grew up poor. He grew up in a capitalist system that was failing in the 1930s during the Great Depression. And his family, they were definitely among the have-nots in Czechoslovakian society. When he was 16 years old, he was sent by his parents to a shoe factory. They said, you're gonna make shoes. They basically said, that's what you're gonna do for the rest of your life. You're gonna work at a shoe factory. Zátopek worked there, but it was here where he also took up running. He ran every chance that he could, day and night. In the winter, he would put on heavy boots. He would take a flashlight. He would go running through the snow. He had no coaches, and so he devised his own training routine. And rather than just run more or less at a steady pace over long distances, as most distance runners did back then, Zátopek devised a routine where he would sprint and then jog, sprint and then jog. And this is what we now call interval training. But nobody did this back then. It was largely Zátopek who invented this idea. In 1939, his training, his running, it was interrupted when the Nazis invaded Czechoslovakia, when the West rolled in. His shoe factory, it was turned into a boot-making factory for Nazi troops. Make boots for your invaders. But then in 1945, Czechoslovakia was liberated by the Soviet Union, by Soviet troops. And then the Soviets and many Czechoslovaks, they began preaching communism. And think how attractive of an idea this would have been to Zátopek. Czech communists, they were promising equality for everyone, promising a system where everyone would do their part. They would do what they did best. And what Zátopek was best at was running. This is what you can do for Czechoslovakia. Under the communist government that took control in Czechoslovakia in 1948, Zátopek was made an officer in the Czech army. But his real job was to run for Czechoslovakia, to represent Czechoslovakia at international sports competitions like the Olympic Games. Why would Emil Zátopek not be enamored with this system? Zátopek first made headlines at the 1948 games. The Soviets weren't there, but Czechoslovakia was. He won gold in the 10,000 meters, that's 6.2 miles. He only got silver in the 5,000 meters. In that race, he said, I went out way too fast. He tired and he got passed at the finish line. But then 4 years later, he's 30 years old now. In 1952, he comes to Finland. And this is where Emil Zátopek goes bonkers. First, he defended his Olympic title in the 10,000 meters. He was the favorite in this race, and he won. Gold medal. Then came the 5,000 meters, which again, he had not won in 1948. He had been passed in the final lap. The 1952 5,000 meters is legendary. It is considered one of the great races in Olympic history for its exciting final lap. We're going to try to watch the end, right? We're going to see if we can do this here. When the bell rang, signaling the final lap, we have the start of that up there, the image, or just let me know when we do. Oh, user error is what I'm hearing. This happens. Thank you. When the bell rang, signaling the final lap, Zátopek burst into the lead, and the crowd went wild, sending another Zátopek victory. But then all of a sudden, Zátopek, he looked totally spent. A German runner zoomed by him. That's the German runner who's in the lead there, about half a lap to go. Zátopek is in second in this still, but a British runner and a French runner, they're right behind him. They are closing fast. So this is where we will pick it up. That's Zátopek in second, number 903. The video version that I chose, sir, is speaking Finnish. And I could play the English version from British TV, but it's cold and passionless and boring. As we're going to see, the English runner actually falls near the end. And in the British version on BBC, the announcer says, the men round the corner and, oh, Chataway falls, what a pity. This announcer is speaking Finnish. I have absolutely no idea what he's saying, but I love the enthusiasm with which he says it. Let's watch.
Mutta mitä nyt? Ihmisveturi ajaa uudella vaihteella kolmelle raiteelle ja ohi koko kolmikon. Toiset taistelevat vimmatusti. Chataway jää, kompastuu, hän kaatuu. Siinä toistui Ilmari Salmisen draama 16 vuoden takaa. Mutta Zátopek ja Mimu ovat jälleen oikeassa järjestyksessä vaalin lähetystä. Zátopek kirii korvia huumaavaan melun aikana voittajaksi. Sellainen on Zátopek näiden kisojen keskeisin voittajahahmo.
Meters. He wins the 10,000 meters, 3 miles and 6 miles. It's remarkable. And then Zátopek goes from Olympic superstar to Olympic god. 3 days after the race we just watched, he enters the marathon, a race he had never competed in. He shows up at the starting line. He looks at his fellow runners and he says in his broken English, men, today we die a little. His strategy was to stay close to the world record holder, the British runner, Jim Peters. And after the first 12 miles, Zátopek, he ran up to Peters and he asked Peters, what do you think of the pace? And Peters told Zátopek, the pace is too slow. He was hoping Zátopek would accelerate and tire himself out. Well, Emil Zátopek, he accelerated and he never decelerated. Running in his first organized marathon, Zátopek won the race by 2 minutes. He set an Olympic record, 2 hours and 23 minutes. And so within the span of 1 week, Emil Zátopek had won the 5,000 meters, the 10,000 meters, the marathon. It's absolutely incredible. It has not happened since. I cannot imagine it will ever happen again. And back home in Czechoslovakia, they celebrated Zátopek for bringing recognition to their nation. And he was held up by the government as evidence of the superiority of the communist system. And then the communist sports system medal count, it kept on going. It would change 4 years later in 1956. As I told you, the 1956 games, they were in Melbourne, Australia. This was the site of the Bloody Pool. And with 4 years more training behind them, the Soviets routed the Americans. Soviet athletes won more of every kind of medal. They won more golds, more silvers, more bronzes. The final tally, it was a rout, 201 for the Soviets, 163 for the Americans. The hometown Australians came in third. This was a loss. That's how it was thought of in the United States. This medal count loss at the Olympic Games, it unleashed a lot of soul searching in this country. American leaders said, we need to do better. And so let's end with what came next. Because if you grew up in the United States, what came next had an effect on your life. American leaders decided, if we're going to compete with the Soviet sports machine, and that's the way Americans always described the Soviets, you know, having this sort of inhuman, impersonal sports machine. American leaders said something needs to change. The 1956 Games suggested that the Soviets were stronger than the Americans, and the Americans were weaker than the Soviets. And one of the culprits, American commentators said, it's our wealth, our national wealth. You know, critics pointed to the affluence of American culture, and they argued that American children, they're spoiled, they're soft. And I think this is really interesting because American affluence, material affluence, was often held up as a sign of American superiority to the Soviets. Our powerful automobiles, our modern kitchen appliances, this demonstrates that we're better than you are. Now, this was an argument famously made by the U.S. Vice President Richard Nixon in the kitchen debates. The widespread availability of these creature comforts, comforts that most Soviets did not have, this was evidence, Nixon said, of the superiority of the American system. But now here, a different argument is being made. Or really, it's being made at exactly the same time that this argument was being made. The exact opposite argument was being made. Now the argument was that all that affluence, it was making Americans weak. Sitting in their air-conditioned homes, eating TV dinners, drinking Coca-Cola, watching Saturday afternoon cartoons, all this affluence was making American children soft. And so in response, you get a Cold War push to whip American school children into shape, and it comes straight from the top. President Dwight Eisenhower created the President's Council on Youth Fitness, and this was a direct response to the belief that American children were weaker than their Soviet counterparts. The goal here was to encourage and foster physical fitness among young Americans, push-ups, pull-ups, the standing broad jump. Max is nodding along. He knows this. This would now be part of the everyday school curriculum of American kids, just like math or spelling. Did you do this? The presidential fitness? Yep, Paul and Max did. Well, that's where it comes from, right? It was created in the 1950s as a way to mold American school children into better future Olympic athletes. We need to win the Cold War medal count against the Soviets. We need to toughen up American kids. So let's exercise them. Let's test them. Let's challenge them in sports. Max and Paul, I vividly remember I had my certificate from Jimmy Carter attesting to the fact that I could attain a certain standard on five events. And I'm going to come clean right here and right now with the microphone on and with the camera in front of me. I want to admit that I cheated on the pull-ups. I didn't think it was fair. I didn't think it was fair that you had to do pull-ups with your knuckles facing you. I could always do chin-ups, but I could never do pull-ups. So when my teacher asked me what my number was, I lied. And I know it's terrible, but in my defense, this was the mid-1970s. I did all this in the shadow of Watergate, so I think it's justifiable. But my point right now is not that I lied to my government. My point is that those tests were a direct response to the Cold War and the athletic threat posed by the Soviet Union. In the name of winning the Cold War Olympics and demonstrating to the world the superiority of the American system, you know, Johnny and Sally need to be more fit than Sergey and Svetlana. All right, I'm gonna wind down here and then I wanna talk about all things related to the Olympics and the Cold War. There never was a military battle between the United States and the Soviet Union, and for that, we can be very thankful. So the Olympic Games were the next best thing, right? Where every 4 years, Americans and Soviets, they waged a different type of physical battle where physical prowess could be assessed. The medal count, it would flip-flop back and forth. Let's see, the Soviets, they won the medal count in 1960. It was actually almost a dead tie in 1964. The Americans, they had a great Olympic team in 1968. Bob Beamon, Tommy Smith, and John Carlos. We'll talk about them next time. They won, the U.S. won the Olympic medal count in 1968. But then the Soviets, they came roaring back in 1972. Back and forth it went. And of course, Cold War tensions were exacerbated in a different way in the 1980s. I mean, maybe we can talk about this. When the United States, US boycotted the Moscow Summer Games in 1980 due to the Soviet invasion of Afghanistan. 4 years later, the Soviets, they boycotted the Los Angeles Games, tit for tat. It was revenge for the American boycott in 1980. Americans and Soviets, they faced off one more time in 1988. Those games were in Seoul. Oh, the Soviets easily won the medal count, actually, in 1988. And then it all came to an end. And I remember it like it was yesterday. I was in college. I was watching it all unfold on CNN, a revolution in Budapest, the Berlin Wall crumbling overnight, the Velvet Revolution in Czechoslovakia, and then the Soviet Union itself collapsing in 1991. And when these revolutions happened, and when the Soviet Union dissolved, I admit it, my first thought was not, hooray, let freedom ring. My first thought was, but what about the Olympics? you can't have the Olympics without the Soviet Union. I mean, without the Soviet Union, what's the point of the Olympic Games? I'm going to end with a quote from the great novelist, John Updike, who said, without the Cold War, what's the point of being an American? All right.
Thank you, Dr. Andrews. What a fantastic talk that was. That's right. Absolutely, so much of this is resonant with our world history since 1945 course and the difficulty of describing whether the Cold War heats up or cools down. We have many questions. Let's go and start at the, we'll go a little bit of a history here from Katie Williams, just about how many years was Coubertin involved in the Olympics? Seems like his finger is in every pie for ages. Yeah. So how long was Coubertin involved with it?
Yeah, Coubertin, right, so he creates it in 1894. He's the head of the IOC all the way through 1924. Actually, that's why the 1924 games are in Paris, because Coubertin made it clear that he was stepping down. So let's let him have the games one more time. Paris had him in 1900. They had him in 1924. They're scheduled to have him again in 2024. That will be the third time Paris gets him. And then he kind of recedes into the distance. Although there's a Coubertin story I've got to tell here. He died right after the Berlin Games in 1936. You know, the most politicized games ever, some people say. He recorded, there was an audio recording that was played at the stadium at the opening ceremony in Berlin in 1936, where he welcomed the nations of the world, and he said something about the Olympic Games, and he died the next year. But in accordance with his wishes, Coubertin's body was buried in Lausanne, Switzerland, which is where the IOC was headquartered after World War I. But in accordance with his wishes, his heart was removed from his body, and it was laid at rest at ancient Olympia, the site of the ancient Olympic Games. Coubertin looms large. And actually, Avery Brundage, the American head of the, he was the head of the, Avery Brundage, who I mentioned, he was an American decathlete in 1912. He was the head of the American Olympic Committee in the 20s and the 30s. And then he becomes the president of the IOC. And he's the president of the IOC from 1952, when the Cold War starts, all the way through the 1972 Munich Games. I mean, so he is there for all of these immensely important politicized games during the Cold War era.
And where's his heart buried?
I don't know. Some people said Avery Brundage actually didn't have a heart. we'll talk about that next time.
Okay, I'm going to combine two questions here. First of all, our friend Abby writes that first Zapotec was stripped of his party membership and army position in 1968.
Yeah.
But the second part of the question, I'm going to link up with something that Jody Meacham asked earlier. What of Soviet and their allies cheating from army jobs to chemical abuses?
Yeah.
And Jody asked, have you ever uncovered any evidence of the United States government working covertly to aid the performance of U.S. athletes?
Yeah. All right. So the Zatopek question is awesome. Emil Zatopek is one of the characters in my Olympics course. We keep coming back to him. Zatopek was a committed communist, believed in the communist system, represented it with distinction in 48 and 52. In 1968, you know, we talked about the Hungarian Revolution. Czechoslovakia had the same thing in 1968, right, Max? The Prague Spring, where a lot of Czech intellectuals and athletes, they signed the 10,000-word manifesto calling for reforms, calling for kind of a break from the Soviet Union. And when Zatopek did that, his career was ruined. He was stripped from his position as a minister, as a sports minister in the Czechoslovakian government. He was told, go up into the forest, dig ditches, clean latrines. I mean, the hero of 1952 lived a very difficult, impoverished life because he tried to stand up. You know, he wasn't trying to get rid of communism like the reformers in Czechoslovakia in 1968. They were just trying to have real communism. Anyway, he paid a price there. And, you know, I ended there with the Velvet Revolution in Prague in 1989, when Czechoslovakia finally got its freedom from the Soviet Union, and people were celebrating and speeches were being given, and someone saw Zatopek, an old man now, he was in the crowd, and they tried to get him to come up and say something, and Zatopek had just been broken since 1968. And he said, I have nothing to say. This is their revolution. I'm tired. And that was it for Zatopek. Sorry, and then you want me to get to the other question about?
Sure. The other one's about, you know, the accusations and of course the evidence of the use of chemical enhancement, but also was there any evidence from the United States?
Yeah, so one of the claims that people always made during the Cold War is that it's not fair. The Soviets are supporting their athletes, right? I mean, they are clearly state-supported athletes, and Americans are true amateurs. That distinction actually isn't right. Yes, the Soviets were supporting their athletes. So it wasn't true amateurism. But think about athletes in the United States. Think about beginning in the 1950s, American athletes were receiving college scholarships, right? You could go to school, we'll house you, we'll feed you, we'll give you an education in exchange for sports. Americans weren't amateurs either. I mean, they were being supported. The great athletes were being supported by the state. And one out of every three American athletes in the 1950s, in the 1960s, they were members of the armed services. They were in the Army, the Marines. Billy Mills is a great example. He was a Marine. He was one of the stars of the 1964 Tokyo Games. And they were being supported by the military. I mean, they worked for the military, but they were allowed to train. They were housed. They were fed. It was exactly like the Soviet athletes were. So first of all, that amateurism distinction is not nearly as sharp as people like to say. The drugs, it gets more complicated. Yep, without a doubt, the Soviet leaders, they discovered the power of anabolic steroids in the 1950s. They were giving it to their weightlifters. The East Germans, they were doing this. They were giving it to their swimmers. The East German women dominated the 1976 Olympic Games, and people were just stunned. We now know that these East German women were being doped, many of them not even knowing they were being doped. And so they just suffered terrible, terrible health consequences. You know, it's interesting. I heard an East German athlete speaking once about coming to the United States. She had willingly doped. And she told a story of coming to the United States in the 1970s for a swim meet. It was actually a joint U.S. East German swim meet. And she talked about walking into a grocery store and seeing fruits and vegetables and fresh meat and all of these healthy food options that Americans and American swimmers had that she did not have back in East Germany. maybe this was her rationalizing what she did, but as she explained it, she said, we took the drugs to even the score. I mean, the Americans, they had all the advantages. So yeah, they had the food, we had the chemicals, we did what we could to keep up. I think that's an interesting consideration. But yeah, we now know without a doubt that there are state-sponsored doping systems. Don't think for a second the Americans weren't doing it. I mean, it wasn't coming from the direction of the Olympic Committee and the American government. The American weightlifters in the 50s and 60s, they were all taking a drug called Dianabol. If you wanted to be on the weightlifting team, the coach, Bob Hoffman, he made it clear you had to take this. People were brazen about it. There was an American weightlifter in the 1970s who said, I'm going to the Olympics. I'm on drugs. They're on drugs. We're going to see whose drugs are better. Everyone was doing it, but that's right. I mean, I'm sorry, who was the person who asked that question?
This is Abby.
Abby's right.
And Jody.
And it's different. It is different because it's not coming from the state. And of course, we now know that the Russians are masterminding another state-sponsored doping system, which is why at these next games, there actually aren't going to be Russians there. There are going to be Olympic athletes from Russia. That's a complicated story. Maybe we'll get to that next time.
Fancy. I want to just hop back to the last lecture we had, and Lloyd Kramer had asked about race in the Olympics and the introduction of non-white athletes and when this happened.
Sure.
I'm also interested about women athletes because I assume that the first athletes were all men. And so some dates on that and how that worked.
When the Olympics began, and this is going to be one of the topics next time, gender. Tomorrow we're going to talk about gender at the games. When the Olympics began, they were all men. Coubertin, he's on record all the way to the end as saying the Olympics should only be for men. No one wants to see women competing in sports. Actually, Avery Brundage, he said similar things. But women began competing at the Olympic Games in 1900. And little by little, the events that they get to compete in, they expand. And I'll give you the whole timeline tomorrow. Black athletes began representing the United States by 1904, maybe even 1900, not 1896. 1896, it was all white Americans. But John Taylor, actually, he was in that photograph that I showed, the 400 meters way back on the last lecture. He won a medal for the United States in 1908. Of course, the famous story is about the great black athletes representing the United States, athletes like Jesse Owens in 1936, kind of making a mockery of Adolf Hitler's claims about Aryan racial supremacy. Let's combine race and gender and talk about black female athletes, right? I think this combines both of these questions. The first woman of African descent, she was African-American, to win a medal was Alice Coachman. She represented the United States at the 1948 Olympic Games. She won an Olympic medal in the high jump. She went to Tuskegee. And here's where black women start becoming part of the narrative for the United States. And what's so interesting about Coachman is that tremendous athlete that she was, Americans didn't care, not interested. There's almost no coverage of her in the 1948 papers. But then the Cold War happens. Right. And now the United States needs to win medals. And now the Soviet female athletes, they're doing well. And this is when Americans actually start caring about female athletics. I mean, you could make the argument that they still don't care. You certainly can make the argument that it wasn't until Title IX comes around in the early 1970s. But in the late 50s and the early 1960s, the American government actually started investing in female athletics. It was Doris Duke. Actually, you know, the Duke fortune, she gave like $1 million to the Olympic Committee, the American Olympic Committee, and said, start funding women's sports. That's where the initial investment came from. And it's in the context of the Cold War that something really interesting happens with regards to black female athletes. Americans start caring about black female athletes because they can win the medals. Athletes like Wilma Rudolph from Tennessee State. Wilma Rudolph goes to Rome in 1960, and she wins 3 gold medals. She helps. The United States doesn't win the medal count, but it would have been even worse without Wilma Rudolph. And Americans celebrate Wilma Rudolph. They start celebrating black female athletes because of the Cold War. People actually start paying attention to them. And more than just celebrating their victories, something really interesting happens in the 1960s. the American press starts talking about Black female athletes and using words like beautiful and graceful and feminine. These are words that the American press did not use to describe Black women all that often. Why are they doing it? They're comparing Black female athletes like Wilma Rudolph to Soviet female athletes, to Eastern European athletes. Mac, you know, I'm sure you remember the stereotypes growing up: manly, brawny, hairy, thick-thighed, Siberian, more man than woman. There's this rhetoric in the 1960s where Black female athletes are described in this way: graceful, feminine, beautiful, in contradistinction to the Soviet athletes. And look, it's sexism, of course, in all sorts of ways. But just want to emphasize kind of what a radical moment is for an American culture that had for centuries described Black women as anything but those things. That narrative starts to change because of the Cold War.
That's interesting about the Cold War and race too, is how much the Soviet Union at this time was pointing at American racism as a, you know, as a sign of America's, you know, inferiority.
Max, and this is to hint at what we're going to talk about next time. The Soviet Union was obviously, you know, making a lot of propaganda gains by saying this, and the United States was always saying, no, look at our Black athletes, look at them on the Olympic stage, we treat everyone the same. And this is why when Tommy Smith and John Carlos raise their fists in 1968 and tell the world we have a serious race problem in the United States, that's why, one of the reasons why it's as big of a deal as it is.
Thank you for that. And I also just want to point out in the chat, we have put Jody Meacham, working for the San Jose Mercury, had written an article about Kazantsev. I hope I'm pronouncing that right. So there's some really great information.
Oh,
we'll
awesome.
We'll share that with you as well. Share,
I'm going to look at it too.
Absolutely. So we have a question here from Jason Beckham, asking, do you have thoughts on the decentralization of hosting the games, expanding the competition site footprint more broadly, creating a broader economic impact, and minimizing some of the overbuilding and other negative results?
So I guess we sort of touched on that a little bit, but I'll respond to that idea of creating a broader economic impact. I mean, really, when we talk about, you know, making the Olympics in one site or just in a couple of sites, we're talking about limiting the economic disaster that comes with hosting the Olympic Games. You know, Max, it's the Montreal Games of 1976 that first started this trend. It was Jean Drapeau was the mayor of Montreal. He was also the head of the Montreal Organizing Committee. And what they like to say about Drapeau in Montreal is that he had an edifice complex. He loved massive buildings, big stadiums. The Big O was the name of the Olympic stadium, O for Olympics. But in Montreal, they called it the Big O, O-W-E, because the people of Montreal and Quebec were going to be paying taxes on it for the next 40 years. I mean, seriously, hosting the Olympics, there are a few nations who can do it, who can handle it. The Chinese certainly feel like they can do it. London, Los Angeles, Paris, those aren't nations, those are cities. But most cities can't do it. It just guts them. I remember when my hometown, San Francisco, was bidding for the Olympic Games in 2012. They were one of the finalists. And I love the Olympics. But I said, please, no. I love my city more. And I don't want it to be destroyed. I don't want it to fall into debt. I don't want new freeways and hotel. I mean, all that stuff has actually been built anyway. But I'm here to tell you, you do not want the Olympic Games coming to your city.
Great. We have this is from Vicky telling us that Jason Beckham is working on the current Olympics Planning Committee in California. So,
okay.
And
probably for the 2028 Games in Los Angeles. And there's a no Olympics in Los Angeles movement. It's not going to be persuasive. The Olympics are going to be there, and Los Angeles can actually do it. Los Angeles can afford it. They have sports stadiums, UCLA, USC, where the Lakers play, where the Rams play, where the Chargers play. I mean, the infrastructure is actually there. LA can definitely bear the burden way better than most cities can.
Great. Thank you for that. Jonathan Gerard asked a little bit about individual athletes. Is there a counter narrative to nationalism that determined fandom In other words, were there Olympics where individual superstars, I'm thinking of Nadia Comaneci in his youth, transcend their national identity and attract fans rooting for them from across the world?
Yeah, that's a great question. And he said Nadia Comaneci, who's the star of the 1976 Games, as is Bruce Jenner, I would argue. But the athlete that I think of, I mean, is from 4 years earlier, 1972, Olga Korbut, another gymnast, 14 years old in 1972. The story of Olga Korbut is so interesting. And I'm thinking mainly the way that Americans responded to Olga Korbut. Again, you know, Soviet women, big, muscular, right? I mean, this was the narrative. And then comes this 14-year-old girl, Olga Korbut, with her pigtails, who does remarkable things on the beam and on the uneven bars, for example. She did this thing called the Korbut flip, which was this backflip that's so astounding and dangerous that you're not even allowed to do it anymore. But what's so interesting about Korbut in 1972, and actually speaks to what Jonathan is talking about sort of transcending the game's individual athletes, transcending this Cold War narrative. Olga Korbut failed in her first event. She did horribly in it. And the announcers were shocked. And everyone watching on TV who had been told, you've got to see this little girl, they were shocked. And she went back to her seat and the camera zoomed in and she started to cry. The tears came down and she was sobbing. And Americans fell in love with her. You know, they had never seen emotion. But we have been told all our lives that Soviets are robots, that they are automatons. And here is this little girl crying. Yes, it absolutely plays into the gender ideas of the time. And Americans fell in love with her. They sent her teddy bears. They sent her love letters in Munich. And then she responded by winning a bunch of medals. So she kind of went from lovable loser to, you know, someone with bounce back ability. She was so popular that the Soviet gymnasts, they came to the United States in 1974. They toured the United States. She met Richard Nixon in the White House. There's a great photograph of her and Nixon. Americans came out in the tens of thousands. They loved Olga Korbut. I mean, so she's an example of an athlete who really had the star power to break down barriers. I mean, she's got so much. You got to... Usain Bolt and Olga Korbut, I think, are the two Olympic athletes in my lifetime with just that wow.
That touring of the, it's interesting, we didn't mention the ping pong diplomacy.
Right.
And also in thinking about the 1970s being detente, where you have the Apollo Soyuz link up in space.
Yep.
So it really fits with these moments that the sports are following the trajectory of the Cold War tensions as well.
Absolutely. So we're talking ping pong diplomacy and detente is a great example there. Yeah.
Fantastic. We have another question from Jason. Do you think that the IOC, ISL, and other similar entities' control of athletic competition for often questionable purposes is holding athletes back both financially and or from a performance perspective? And he's referencing an article in Outside Magazine, April's Outside Magazine by Alex Perry, that had some interesting alternatives to the way it worked.
Huh. Well, I haven't seen the article, so I can't comment on that. Look, I can comment on this. Without a doubt, for 100 years, the IOC held back the earning potential of athletes with that rule about amateurism. And even when the IOC started making a lot of money, they held to that line that the athletes must remain amateurs. By insisting on amateurism, they held back on the athletic potential of those athletes. You know, guys, men, women, they were in the Olympics once. You can go in the Olympics when you're 22 and sprint, but how can you do it 4 years later? How can you support yourself? If you can't make money competing in sports, how are you going to do it? And so it's not until the late 1980s, and it really begins in earnest at the Barcelona Games in 1992, that the IOC loosens the reins. They have a new president, Juan Antonio Samaranch, and he kind of came to the conclusion that we need to enter the modern era when it comes to sports. He came to the conclusion that people wanted to see the same athletes over and over, Michael Phelps, Usain Bolt. I think he was absolutely right. And it's beginning in 1992 that I think you can make the argument that we truly, for the first time, get the world's greatest athletes at the Olympic Games. The critique that I'm much more familiar with about what the IOC is doing right now, and this is something we're going to talk about in our second session tomorrow, is that the IOC is denying athletes their human rights by not allowing them to voice their political ideas and protest at the games. The IOC has very, very specific rules about what athletes can and cannot do. It's going to be interesting in 2021 if it happens. We're going to talk about this next time. But I'm also very interested in looking at this article that was referenced, because I'm not exactly sure what the...
And you will get up. What we've been doing is we've been putting in any references. We'll give you a chat transcript so you can see this wonderful
Perfect.
Article, as well as a link to Jody Meacham's article on Presentsev as well.
Wonderful.
We have come to, well, we have 1 minute left, but I don't see any more questions. So I will just maybe just pose one question to you.
Sure.
How about other international sports, other bodies? Like, when does this start? Because we know that these people compete outside of the Olympics. Did those other international bodies for the individual sports, were they born out of the Olympics? Because is that how that works?
Yeah. So most sports, every sport has an international federation. Every sport. There's a volleyball international federation. There's a field hockey federation. There's a football federation. It's called FIFA, right? I mean, that's the most famous one. You know, it's interesting to go back to the idea of nationalism. You know, at the games, there are national Olympic committees and there are sports federations. The athletes identify with the national Olympic committees, really, not the sports federations. Again, it could be, here are the volleyball players, here are the weightlifters, but they identify with the nations. Coubertin wanted the Olympics to be the championship for every sports federation. And you know, sports have world championships, but ask a swimmer, do they want to win the world championship or the Olympic Games? They want to win the Olympic Games. Football, I'm going to say football, I mean soccer, but football is such an interesting example, Max. In the early game, there was football beginning in 1900 at the games. And then FIFA wanted to get they wanted the best players in the Olympics. But the International Olympic Committee said, no, amateurs only. And FIFA said, no, 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 we want to grow this sport. Our best players make money, starting to make money in places like England. And so they begged the Olympics, let us have athletes who can make money. The Olympics said no. So in 1930, FIFA said, all right, fine, we're going to leave the Olympics and we're going to create our own tournament. It's called the World Cup.
We've heard of it.
Yeah, and we've heard of it. I mean, imagine if the World Cup was part of the Olympics. I don't think it's possible. It's just too big. But that was FIFA breaking away from the Olympics for their overly traditional ideas and saying, we're just going to do it our way.
Just like everything we've heard tonight, so many eye-opening insights into the Olympics. Matt, I want to thank you. Dr. Andrews, thank you so much.
Anderson, you got it wrong.
Yeah, whatever. Thank you so much. We'll see you tomorrow night. And
yeah,
please come on back, folks. We're looking forward to two more talks. Send us your questions. Line up, sign up, get involved. We'll see you tomorrow. Thanks so much.
All right.